you who have kindly joined to listen to Professor Tridip Suhrud. He is professor and provost at CEPT University in Ahmedabad and director of Lalbhai Dalpatbhai Institute of Indology in Ahmedabad. Professor Suhrud has a background in economics. He's done his MA in economics, has another MA in political science, and has done a PhD in political science. He has held many positions, too many of them for me to actually inform you, but he's been the director and chief editor of Sabarmati Ashram Preservation and Memorial Trust, which is really of importance and relevance to today's event, because today's event is Gandhi and science. So that's very relevant to today's event. He's also been a fellow of the Indian Institute of Advanced Study in Shimla for many years. Importantly, he's a series editor, and he has been the series editor since 2006 on Gandhi studies of the Orient Black Swan. So, and he has held many other positions, which are just too many for me to name. He has written 31 books. He's a very prolific writer. He's written 31 books, well written, authored, translated. These books have been on Gandhi, on Rabindranath Tagore, and on many other aspects of societal importance. He writes also articles very regularly, and that's many pages long for just the titles of the various articles that he has written over the years. But with 31 books to his credit, you can imagine that he's a prolific writer and most importantly, a prolific thinker. Today, we have assembled to hear from him, how do we think with ants, work as freedom? But before that, also, let me tell you that he's very well decorated. I'll just mention a few. He's gotten the Katha Award in 1999, the Sahitya Academy Award in 2010, Niranjan Bhagat Memorial Award in 2019, and so on. So let me thank Professor Suhrud for kindly agreeing to give this, to deliver this talk on science and the frontiers of humanity. Today's topic is thinking with hands, work as freedom. Professor Suhrud.
Thank you very much. I'm greatly and deeply honored that you should ask me to speak to the fellows of the Academy of Sciences. Let me go straight into what I'm trying to do this afternoon, which is to explore what are the aspects of freedom with which the Indian leadership, the Indian national movement, grappled with. And I will take my case through the example of Gandhi, because that's really something which is intended, but I will also bring in poet Tagore occasionally to illustrate what one seeks to do. On 10th March 1922, Gandhi was arrested for a very familiar charge of sedition. We continue, unfortunately, to be governed by the same set of laws. And when you're arrested and taken to prison, the normal thing is form filling. He was required to fill out a form in which he had to state what his profession was. I mean, he could have written a professional agitator is my profession. He didn't do so. He gave a very curious answer to this question. He said that he was a farmer and a weaver. And that's a very curious answer. It's not an untrue answer. We know that he wove, but we don't think that we've not have many images of him as a peasant. We even have fewer images of him weaving. We have images of him spinning. So what is that Gandhi trying to do by signaling that he was a farmer and a weaver? Is it merely a symbolic act? And if it's a symbolic act, what does it seek to symbolize? So that's really one thing that I've... let's try and understand what somebody from Gandhi's background, social background, economic background, political background, to state that he was somebody who worked with his hands was a very unusual thing. He was a middle caste person, Banya, trained as a professional, trained as a barrister, and had practiced as a barrister for a very long time. We have this notion that Gandhi was a bad lawyer, which comes to us partly from his own self-deprecatory remarks about his legal practice. But as historians, we don't necessarily have to take everything that he says for at face value. We know that he was one of the most successful lawyers in South Africa, successful not only in the kind of public interest litigations that he instituted, and those of you who are familiar with jurisprudence regarding public interest would know that among the people who pioneered the entire idea that justice should be available not only to an aggrieved party, but it's something which is a much wider notion. It's available to us as people, as human beings, and that there is, even if I were not an aggrieved party, I could actually seek to be seek redressal to an injustice in public interest, is something that Gandhi instituted in South Africa. So he's an extremely successful lawyer in South Africa. So neither his training nor the work that he had done as a professional for close to 20 years would signify that he was somebody who was a peasant or a weaver. What Gandhi is trying to tell us are two things. One is that he is making a very specific intervention in the sociology of India, in the way Indian society, and not just Indian society, but largely the Indian subcontinent. If one were to think in terms of the South Asia as constituting a large subcontinent, we've had a very peculiar notion in Hindu society, and that notion has percolated to other social groups, religious systems as well, which is that working with hands is somehow polluting. Working with hands is a lower order of engagement. Working with hands is for people who are not free. Let me give an example. We know that there is, well, all of us, whether we are sociologists or not, we know that there is a hierarchy. That hierarchy is called caste, and it's based on this very pernicious idea that we are born into a caste. There is no way for one to change one's caste, and the ascription of our caste order, caste hierarchy, comes from a notion of purity and pollution. This is not only a ritual notion of purity and pollution. All of us are ritually impure at some point. I would be impure after the cremation of my father or my mother. I would be impure if I had performed a certain kind of an act. If I were a woman, I would be considered ritually impure every time I were to menstruate or give birth to a child. So there is a notion of ritual purity and impurity, which is very peculiar to Hindu imagination, to Indian imagination, in fact. But there is also another kind of impurity which underlies this, which is somehow hidden, which is something that we don't talk about, which is that we've also created a hierarchy of materials, or hierarchy of material engagement, which in some ways intrinsically linked to our notion of purity and pollution, as to some materials and some activities which are related to these materials, which are seen as polluting. We know that in our understanding, in our way of categorizing materials, the most impure is the dead body, both human dead body, and even more impure is the dead body of a carcass of an animal. So those who work with either disposing these dead bodies or skinning these bodies in case of cattle would be considered as having dealt with the most impure form of material. And therefore, they would be outside the pale of caste even. They would be outside the pale of caste, and therefore, they would be outside the pale of civilization or civitas. They would be outside the pale of society. Their physical location would also be outside the limits of that town or whatever that habitation is. Just above the disposing of or the dealing with the dead is dealing with human and bovine waste. So anybody who has to work as a scavenger would be equally impure. These deals with waste and our understanding of what constitutes undesirable and polluting elements. Equally true is the way we create a hierarchy of materials. And these are all artisanal communities that we're talking about. Within the artisanal communities and within the materials, the purest would of course be gold. So there would be a category of people that you call goldsmiths, and then there would be people who deal with a lower order of material, which is iron, and therefore the ironsmiths, a material lower than iron in our ritual hierarchy is wood, and so therefore there would be carpenters, and a material lower than that would be cloth, and therefore there would be weavers and spinners, and the material right below that would be earth or mud, and therefore potters. So we've created our caste system and all the humiliation, iniquity, injustice, violence that comes with having created this and perpetuated this is somehow, you know, the base of it is really this hierarchy of materials. And that is one part of Indian sociology that we have really not explored. And therefore, all the artisanal communities, depending upon your status of the material that you use, would be considered as people who's in today's legal, constitutional, political language, you would call other backward communities, including some of these would be included in scheduled caste communities, which would be the Dalit communities. Of course, the purest form of activity is what many of us do, which is pure thought. So if your activity is to deal with something non-material, something so ephemeral and therefore so pure as thought itself, one would occupy that activity, and the people doing that activity would occupy a different kind of position in the way the society evaluates them, the self-perception of the people who are doing this. So what Gandhi understands, and Gandhi is among the first people in modern India to be very conscious of the fact that there is not only a hierarchy of people, there is a hierarchy of material. And there is a material life which binds people to the acts of unfreedom, to chains, bondage, ritual and otherwise, economic and otherwise. And we know that each of these activities would be valued less in terms of its economic exchange value than activities which are of a higher order of material. So therefore, the remuneration or wage, the wage labor as it is counted, has also a relationship to the materiality of the activity that we do. So anybody doing physical work would actually be paid less than somebody doing intellectual work. And that's so there is a reflection. So it's tied to economy. It's tied to political economy. It's tied to access to resources. It's also tied to self-perception, identity. So the way in which the social organization is created has a very deep and a direct relationship to the material engagement that you do. So for somebody like Gandhi, and somebody who is not born into an artisanal community, in fact, he's born into a political family. We forget that his father and grandfather before him and great-grandfather before him were all, to use the traditional term, divans, so administrators, and they were called prime ministers of three states. So he is somebody who's born into a political family. He's born into a family that has exercised great amount of political authority over a small native state, but nevertheless, a very important personage within that administrative structure. For him to identify himself as somebody who works with his hands was, to speak of it, was, if not necessarily a revolutionary act, it was something which was both unexpected. It was a deviation. You could call it a deviant act if you so like. How does Gandhi come to this? Because there's nothing in his early childhood, or and we know that at a very young age he left India, like all Gujaratis wish to do, and went to England. Three very, very interesting, fascinating years in which he spent in England, in London, exploring range of philosophical ideas, range of aesthetic ideas, trained himself into his early training in politics takes place there. His training in law, of course, takes place. And he also sees a large part of the world. Very curious young man. In fact, you would be happy to note that he is somebody who was present when the Great Exhibition in Paris opens, and he's among the first visitors to this Ajuba that we now recognize as the Eiffel Tower. He's there, and he in fact spends money, you'll be surprised, to have a meal atop the tower. He does not like the meal. It's an unsatisfactory meal, but he is curious. I mean, he's curious about the world. And it is that person who goes to South Africa, and in the first initial 2 years of his stay there, begins to practice law rather successfully, begins to organize the community there. Something happens in South Africa. He comes into contact with two kinds of people, two kinds of philosophical ideas. And not people as in there are people, but there are also philosophical ideas. One of his closest friends, associates, a lifelong companion, people, person that with whom he lived for a very long time together, was Herman Kallenbach, a very, very fine architect who practiced in South Africa. But Kallenbach was in the good European tradition of the 19th century, was trained into a range of abilities, trained into a range of artisanal practices or industrial practices as well. He's a bricklayer, so he is not only an architect, but he knows masonry. He's a trained cabinet maker in the Germanic tradition, so he's a very fine carpenter. Among other things, a bodybuilder. So he was given to wrestling and exercising his body and looked at the body very differently. So Kallenbach and Gandhi together begin to explore. It is under Kallenbach's personal influence that Gandhi begins to look at bodily work very differently. Nothing in his previous life would tell us that Gandhi would look at bodily work as an essential thing. What comes along with it, that we should know that both Kallenbach and Gandhi are very close readers of Tolstoy. And And it is Tolstoy, it is the kind of Tolstoyan Christianity that both of them subscribe to. Both of them are very deeply attracted, and you would know that this large community housed in 1,100 acres of land that Kallenbach owned was called the Tolstoy Farm. So the influence of Tolstoy and his thought is very evident. What does Gandhi learn from Tolstoy, apart from reading his novels, is that he actually learns through Tolstoy and Ruskin a very, very fine idea, two fine ideas, both deeply biblical. One is that you should live by the sweat of thy brow, that any food that you consume must be a product of your own labor. And along with that, Tolstoy gives him the idea, reminds him of the idea of the of unto this last, which is the parable of the vineyard from the Bible, as a notion of equity and justice. So they're both attracted to this idea that you need to create a community which looks at bodily labor, engagement with material world in a different kind of a way. So the first community that Gandhi established, and he does not call it an ashram, and therefore I'm not going to call it an ashram, is in fact a settlement, which is called the Phoenix Settlement, named after the place in which this community was. Gandhi purchased this large tract of land, measuring about 110 acres at that point, and wanted to create a community based on both Tolstoyan ideas and ideas of Ruskin about how to lead a life of honest physical labor, how to create an equitable distribution of resources, access to resources through that, and the first experiments in agriculture, both private and community agriculture, or what you would call a commune, begin at the Phoenix Settlement. The Phoenix Settlement also is a unique community. It's based around not only agriculture, it's actually based around a print culture. It's based around the printing press. Gandhi, as you would know, was fascinated by newspapers and printing technology. After 1903, there's not been a day in his life that he has not owned and edited a newspaper. The idea of the newspaper is not necessarily a daily. Some of these tended to be either a fortnightly or a weekly. Indian Opinion, which is something that Gandhi ran while he was in South Africa and which continued to run till 1955-56, and contributed a great deal first to the anti-colonial struggle, then the struggle against apartheid, and then became very much aligned itself to the ANC, was a journal, a newspaper opinion journal that Gandhi founded. It was also among the world's first multilingual newspapers, simultaneously published in four languages, Gujarati, Hindi, English, and Tamil. On special occasions, it came out in six languages, which apart from these four included Telugu and Urdu. So here is, and the printing press is at the heart of this enterprise. So each one contributed their bodily labor to run the printing press. The treadles of the press had to be worked, not necessarily by a machine, but through human labor. And no outside coolie labor, as they were called, is employed. It is the community which participates into running of this enterprise. Printing before the digital age also required composition. So the composition of of each page, each line, each word is done by this community. So the bodily labor around the machine and bodily labor in the farm are very much central to the idea of the Phoenix community. And that's really where Gandhi begins to think of work as liberating. Work as liberating, not only in terms of providing livelihood and therefore liberating one from poverty and the violence that's associated with poverty and hunger, but the capacity of work to free one from the social bondage that work itself and material engagement places one in. It's around the same time that both Kallenbach and Gandhi more than Kallenbach, are attracted to this very beautiful monastery close to Johannesburg called the Marian Hill Monastery, which exists even today. Part of that has been converted into a cloister, but it was a Trappist monastery. And the Trappist monks, as we know, are great makers of things. They're great makers of cheese and wine, but they're also great makers of objects. Like the Shakers and the Quakers, they make exquisite furniture. But the speciality of, or the special skill that this Trappist monastery had was in terms of making leather, working with leather. Now we know that working with leather in the Indian social system brings one close to the bottom of the social hierarchy, to the bottom of the ritual order. Chamars, as they are called, people who work with leather, both skinning the animals and making footwear out of them or other leather products, are among those who have been considered untouchable, and they've been oppressed, and that oppression continues. So Gandhi is attracted to the Trappist monks and begins to look at leather as an object that he would want to work with. Those of you who are fond of footwear or the history of footwear in India would know that India has always neglected footwear. We revere feet, but do not like footwear. Our lack of ability to be innovative in terms of footwear design is something that anybody who's worked like me in design institutions, be them the National Institute of Design or my present institution, CEPT, would tell you that no self-respecting Indian wants to work on footwear design. Gandhi began work with footwear. And we know that there is one design of footwear that is associated with it, which is called either the Sabarmati chappals or called the Gandhi Patti chappals. But in fact, there are five other designs that Gandhi worked on. Some of these are part of now museums. You would also remember this very telling story of Gandhi gifting a pair of chappals that he had made, or sandals that he had made, to General Jan Smuts as his prisoner. That was the work that he had done as a prisoner of General Smuts, and gifted him this pair of sandals. And these sandals now are part of the heritage of South Africa, and are very, they're still very attractive. The kind of minimalism that one associates with Gandhi's aesthetics is all there. So he began to work on leather. So South Africa gave him the idea that, and the training, not just the idea, but the training to work, begin to work with materials, large agriculture, leather, and with printing press, and with Kallenbach, a certain understanding of how space is organized, how space is created, what we would call doing architecture, but also certain amount of facility of being a carpenter, being able to fix roofs, beams, supporting structures is something that Gandhi learns. So those of you who know history of architecture or are interested in history of Indian architecture would know that there is now a great deal of renewed interest in the things that Gandhi built. We know that the entire design of Sevagram, for example, the Bapu Kutir at Sevagram was something that he helped do. But those of you who've been to Radhe Kunj at Sabarmati would be struck by the simplicity, the elegance, but also a non-vernacularness of Radhe Kunj. And that's something that Gandhi learned to do alongside Kallenbach. So he is somebody who helped design homes, not just in South Africa, but also primarily in India, at two ashramic communities, one being at Sabarmati, the other at Sevagram. And there is a kind of an aesthetic of Gandhi's architecture that is now being seriously studied in the last few years. So the Gandhi that comes to India in 1915 is somebody who looks at materials, work with the body in a very non-Hindu, non-middle caste Hindu professional way. He begins to look at work as enabling body as something that work as something that grants one freedom, primarily at one level from poverty and hunger, but also work and material engagement as freeing one from the social taboos and the bondage that is associated with that. Two other experiences, formative experiences in India begin to reinforce some of that. One is, of course, is in Champaran. We've really done no work, real work on Champaran till very recently. What is called Champaran Satyagraha is actually a judicial, quasi-judicial inquiry. Gandhi, Rajendra Prasad, and five other lawyers actually speak to the peasantry and the numbers that we're looking at is 70,000 peasants. So there's no sample survey that Gandhi believes in. Gandhi is talking to every peasant who's cultivating indigo. And these testimonies are recorded. These testimonies have just been discovered after a gap of 100 years, and the first volume of which should be published within the next fortnight or so. I'm one of the persons who's actually associated with that exercise. But what you begin to understand that Gandhi, by talking to these 70,000 peasants, and we have today 7,000 written testimonies which are signed or thumbprinted by peasants and corroborated by others. So we're looking at a very large corpus of peasant testimony. In fact, it would be the world's largest archive of peasantry in modern times that we would be able to open up with the publication of the first volume. Gandhi began to understand the political economy, not of only of indigo cultivation, but of land, land tenure, land revenue, the nature of indebtedness that the peasantry had. And then he began to understand is to the both the legal and the illegal measures by which Indian peasantry came to be subjugated, not only during the British colonial period, but it is something that preceded that. So the entire land tenure system that we inherited, both in terms of a permanent settlement and the Rayatwari, is something that Gandhi understood, not in a theoretical way, but through very concentrated 5 months of field work, if that's the word that we wish to use, in Champaran. While Champaran's happening, Gandhi is in Ahmedabad as well, working with a very different kind of labor, which is the industrial labor. you know that Ahmedabad and Bombay were among the were among the first major centers to be industrialized in western part of the subcontinent. Very large textile industry. Ahmedabad employed close to 75,000 textile laborers in 1917-1918, and Gandhi gets engaged in creating, supporting the first major strike of the textile workers seeking fair wage and remuneration. What happens during those 3 days is not important. What happens thereafter is the practice that was done in Champaran is followed again in Ahmedabad, that Gandhi and two of his associates, one trained as an economist at the London School of Economics, a man called Shankar Lal Banker, and another remarkable woman, partly trained, I mean, self-taught and taught at home, Anasuya Sarabhai, the mill owner Ambalal Sarabhai's sister. So Shankar Lal Banker, Anasuya Sarabhai, and Gandhi and the other associates go about doing this massive survey of the condition of industrial labor in India. So the idea that the traditional physical labor of agriculture is something that creates one kind of bondage, and the modern, very, very modern industrial production systems create other forms of bondage is something that Gandhi begins to be very, very aware of. And it is in that backdrop that Gandhi began to intervene in the materials. We should be conscious of two things. These are not theoretical engagements also only. They translate, as they always do in case of Gandhi, into institutional interventions, into political interventions, into self-practices that he would adopt. And it is in light of that, that spinning and weaving become, as he calls, the symbols of acts of freedom. Now, Khadi becomes, as Nehru said, the library of India's freedom. Why does a textile become the library of India's freedom? Because it is imbued with the work that women and men do. There are two other aspects that we need to be certain of. One is that Gandhi is not only talking about physical labor, he's also challenging in some ways the gender division of work that happens. The work that Gandhi is most associated with, which is spinning, those of you who study spinning and weaving industries or are familiar with it would know that spinning is considered to be a woman's work, and weaving is considered to be a male domain, except in certain matrilineal communities where women also work the loom, but most looms are worked on by man. So by valorizing or making spinning as a symbol of India's freedom, what Gandhi was seeking to do was also look at the gender division of labor that's evident in all material aspects, the remuneration that they receive, the kind of recognition of women's work and labor that is there, or in fact, which is not there. So that's one aspect. Gandhi is not satisfied by making symbolic interventions. These are important. He knows that symbolic interventions have a place in the political discourse, but they do not necessarily change the material condition of life of people. He, along with this amazing economist, a man called Joseph Cornelius Kumarappa, who in fact was the first economist in the world to speak of what we today call sustainability. He used a much more beautiful, more evocative term called the economy of permanence. And those of you who are at the Indian Institute of Sciences in Bangalore would know that your colleague, Venu Madhav Govindu, who's done this magnificent biography of Kumarappa would tell you that he and Gandhi together do the first major survey of indebtedness in rural India. And this is the indebtedness, what is called the survey of Matar Taluka. And they look at what constitutes indebtedness, what are the reasons for indebtedness, what leads to forced migrations, and together they create an institutional mechanism, in fact, two institutional mechanisms. The All India Weavers Association and All India Spinners Association, kind of a federating body of individual weavers who come together either as individuals or as cooperatives to create. So the entire Amul Dairy experiment that we done with Dr. Tribhuvandas Patel and Dr. Kurian, in fact, mirrors the experience of what was happening in the All India Weavers and Spinners Association. So that's something that we should remember. But Gandhi is not just satisfied having created institutional mechanisms. He wants to tinker with things. He is somebody who would, he was a bricklayer. He wanted to work with his hands constantly to improve things, make them better, make them more interesting. His sense of his facility with carpentry came in handy. You know that there is a very familiar charkha, a spinning wheel that a lot of people use. Those who do symbolic spinning, or those who wish to do spinning for now other reasons, ecological or of well-being, they use a kind of a box charkha which folds up. That entire contraption, which is called the Yaravda Chakra or Yaravda Charkha or Yaravda Wheel, was something that Gandhi designed. It gets its name from the prison where he was at Yaravda, where he made this collapsible spinning wheel, which was also very easily portable and could be carried around. So he works with charkha. He understands all aspects of making of the charkha and minimizes that. Not satisfied with what having done, he in fact launched India's first proper design competition. And it's not an accident that Ahmedabad got the National Institute of Design. The first proper design competition is announced in 1927 by Gandhi, which carried a prize in those days of 100,000 rupees. To design a multi-spindle spinning wheel. And the competition went on till even after Gandhi's death, and what today we call the Ambar Charkha, which is really a multi-spindle. At that point, it was a six-spindle charkha, which was operated through a foot paddle, was designed as part of that competition. So he wants to make innovations, he wants to make improvements in the machines that with which you deal with. It also gives you an idea that if you were to look at the Yaravda Chakra, the idea of what today we would call ergonomics, which is the understanding of body in work, body in motion, body at rest, body engaging with something which is outside of itself. So there is an entire aspect of spinning, weaving, agriculture that goes on. His work with leather continues. Added to that are two other dimensions that I want to speak about, and then and not take more time. One is the work with dyes, natural dyes. We don't associate Gandhi with color. We associate Gandhi with this stark beauty of unbleached white. But in fact, there was a dyeing unit at the Sabarmati Ashram. If I could just turn around and show it to you, if I could find it. Gandhi worked with natural dyes, with natural colors, and created an entire palette of colors which could actually go and apply on khadi. because not everybody was convinced that the colorless khadi was the most desirable thing. A lot of young women and not so young women like Asuba told him that they were not willing to wear an entirely stark, unadorned khadi. So there is the work that he does on colors, natural dyes, which continued in his work at Wardha also. And even today, some of the finest work on innovation on weaving and spinning and natural dyes is carried on at Wardha by this remarkable person called Dr. Vibha Gupta. So there is a continuation of that. So there is a work and a lot of work that he does with natural dyes and colors that happens both under his guidance, but he also does it. When I say he does it, I'm not speaking as these are things that he should have done, and we are ascribing it to him. There is actually in the archives of the Sabarmati Ashram a priceless object. This is a sari that he made for Kasturba. In fact, he wove two saris for Kasturba. This was so he would spin the yarn, weave it, dye it, and gift it to Ba. He in fact made two saris. One she was cremated in. The other is with the Sabarmati Ashram. So you can see that there is this lovely madder dye of Gujarat and Rajasthan. There with some very minimal block printed work that's happened. So he is somebody who's working with color, with dyeing. But the more important work that he does is with human waste, with sanitation. Because one clear and marked aspect of untouchability was carrying of night soil. And Gandhi realizes that carrying of night soil will continue so long as we do not create improved toilets. And his obsession with cleaning, with sanitation is something that is well known. What is well not known so much is the work that he does in terms of designing toilets. If you were to come to Gujarat and go to something which is called Safai Vidyalay, which is part of the larger Ashram precinct, you would see that there are 26 kinds of toilets that Gandhi worked on, along with a lot of other people. I mean, he's not the only one who's doing it, but he's causing that to happen. We also know that he cleaned shit, he carried shit, but he also thought of way of improving the entire system of human waste carriage, of disposal, and the sanitary conditions of or the insanitary conditions of our toilets, if they existed, and if they did not exist, how do you actually go about creating both private and community toilets? So Gandhi's work on sanitation, agriculture, textiles, leather, dyeing continued through his life. What he was seeking to do was to present to us one idea of freedom, which was very crucial and central to the large part of India. Because to speak of political freedom without a freedom from social bondage, without the freedom from stigma, from freedom from humiliation, freedom from poverty, from hunger, from the violence that's inherent in all these structures, was to speak only of freedom in a very limited sense. And so for Gandhi, work really becomes the mode of engaging with freedom. He's not the only one. I think the one aspect about Rabindranath Tagore and their interaction together is something that we don't recognize, is that Tagore also experimented in his own way on a lot of these things. We think of poet Tagore as somebody who paints, who creates music, who writes sublime poetry, does very interesting theater. But we forget that Tagore actually created another institution, right very, very close to Shantiniketan, which is called Shriniketan, which really sought to engage with the same set of issues that, that Gandhi was talking about: improvement of agriculture, of sanitary conditions, of working with rural craftsmen and their imagination, improving their conditions, creating markets for their produce. And he worked with renowned experts from across the world to seek to improve the lot of India's peasantry. You would also know that his own son, Ratindranath, was trained in agricultural science. So he does not train his son into music. And, I mean, that is part of one's training, but his formal qualification, Ratindranath's formal qualification was in agricultural sciences. So it's not only Gandhi who is thinking about work. The person that we least associate with him, with such activities, which is Poet Tagore, is also. So what seems to be happening during the national movement, and I'm not taking other examples, but between these two individuals and their institutions, what you find is that a much broader, more humane, more socially rooted, more politically charged notion of freedom, both human and societal, is being thought through, where work is at the center, where the human body is at center, and through that work, by subverting these hierarchies, by seeking to disassociate materiality and purity, Gandhi and Tagore, but primarily Gandhi, because that's who I've spoken about today, is rethinking the ideas of freedom. And it is working through hands and the ideas that this work and this engagement with the material world and with the work, with work, that one gets, is something that constitutes a very large part of our imagination about freedom. Thank you very much. Great pleasure. Thank you.
Professor Suhrud, thank you very much. This was just as I'm overwhelmed with a lot of thoughts and ideas that you presented. I'm pretty sure that all of your audience would also have been overwhelmed. Most of us can't ask questions directly, but they will put their questions in the chat box and I can narrate them to you. I will start with a question of mine, which pertains to something that you spoke about early on in your talk, which is a hierarchy of materials like iron, wood, and so on, cloth. I understand that along with that materials hierarchy, there is also a social hierarchy that automatically got construed or built. But who actually provided, or where is it enshrined that there is this hierarchy of materials? We see the hierarchy of social structures, but where is the hierarchy of materials, or how is that thought come about?
It's interesting that you should ask that, because these are not necessarily things which are written down. These are social practices and customs which come over time. So to say, how does the notion of ritual purity, ritual purity and impurity is one, but this permanent notion of purity and impurity, we know, is associated with the work that one does, with the nature of work that these communities or individuals in these communities do. So therefore, social hierarchy is very deeply and intrinsically linked to the work culture. And work culture is embedded in the material world, in the materiality of things. So the kind of fine hierarchy, the Varna, 4-4 Varna is a very gross system, but the kind of fine placement of individuals in social structures that we seem to do is related to the material embedment, embedding in the material world. It's not written down. It is something that has evolved and continues to remain with us over millennia and in the way the social systems have come about. So if we were to looking at texts, you would not find. But what you would find very interesting work that has begun to be done by anthropologists is to really look at how these communities' own self-perceptions have changed, what kind of worldviews began to be emerged, what kind of texts they began to write. So the Vishwakarmas, both as builders and as doing building work, so construction primarily of temples to begin with, or construction of large royally structures or religious structures, but then also secular structures. They began to write compendiums. So very interesting work now is being done on the text that the Vishwakarmas wrote. Similarly, there are texts that other people have written. Let's say there is the work now which is being done very recently, last week, in fact, was published from the Bombay Nautical Society, the Bombay Naval History Society, along with a scholar from Gujarat, on the navigational manuals that sailors wrote. So now it's only now that we've actually become sensitive to the question that you asked as to, is there textual evidence? What is the worldview that these communities had? How did they interpret their place in the world and the work that they did? What is the knowledge that was required for one to carry on, let's say, either a boat building activity or navigational activity or building activity? I mean, you can't say only that there is the Vastu Purusha, but the building activity goes way beyond. It has to go into engineering aspects, into structural aspects. So it's only now that Indian sociology or Indian anthropology, Indian history has begun to create this archive and write very illuminating material and scholastic studies on them.
If I could push my question a little bit further, without boring the audience or without boring you. What I'm understanding from what you just said regarding this hierarchy of material vis-a-vis the hierarchy, the Varna system, or the hierarchy of the society that exists, the hierarchy of the society preceded this notion of hierarchy of materials, and it stemmed as a corollary from primarily from the kind of materials that these sections of society worked with. Am I getting you right that this is a sort of stretching of imagination or a corollary of our imagination, that there is an intrinsic social stratification of materials which actually stems from social stratification of humans in our society?
I'm hazarding a guess here. I would want to think other way. I think the social stratification arises out of our understanding of materials and our disgust with certain kinds of material engagement. For example, the dead body, that of the animal or the human, or disposal of human waste, or dealing with leather, or doing very, very backbreaking physical work. So I do tend to think that both these processes probably would have gone on simultaneously. But the basis of social stratification, I've now begun to think, and I'm saying that I'm hazarding a sociological guess here, is that the base of it, the foundations of it, are in our disgust with the grossness of material life. And also, you know, so this entire idea that thought is pure thought. I don't have to tell scientists as to how do you create hierarchies among the sciences as well, between pure and applied. And I mean, so there has been very interesting discussions that we can get into. But I think these my sense is, or my hunch now is really that the social stratification is actually based on material stratification.
There's a question in the chat box. The question is from Professor Renee Borges, and she's asking, in tribal societies, what types of material hierarchy existed, or did it not exist?
Well, the tribal societies had material hierarchies, and there is, but the kind of strict division of labor, so the kind of work that we have, and the kind of work that people, the earlier anthropologists have done, and the kind of work that is now coming out from groups like the work that is being done at the Bhasha Academy at Tejgad, show two things. Since these communities lived outside the pale of caste societies and lived outside the pale of settled agricultural or peasant economies and societies which were built around it, did not absorb all the ideas of the caste society. What they have is, and therefore the relationship to labor is both in terms of the worldview and in terms of the actual fact is very different. But now in the sense, the tribal communities which are present today, not of our imagination, not of the past, have begun to absorb a large part of the notions of hierarchies of materials of the caste societies. And when, for example, when a migrant tribal worker comes from the eastern belt of Gujarat into a city like Ahmedabad to work as casual labor, either on a construction site or other kinds of labor, their valuation back home in their societies has begun to change, which is a reflection of their close interaction and now co-inhabiting, as the most exploited group of the caste structure. So that has begun to change. But if you were to look at the earlier records which are being provided to us by 19th and early 20th century anthropology, one does not see that kind of a stark difference in terms of social stratification, because they had no notion of, not such deep notion of a hierarchy based on purity and impurity. But it's begun to come, and that's, I think, what worries a lot of tribal thinkers, political leaders, and those who work with them.
There's one more question. Professor Suhrud, this is a fascinating, your talk was fascinating. Thank you. The talk shed a lot of light on machine-human interactions as well. We are now moving into a phase where we are uncertain as to how new technology is going to change different sectors and individuals associated with those sectors, as for example, through the use of artificial intelligence. Are there any pointers from Gandhian thought or Gandhian literature as to how to tackle the potential challenges here?
You know, it's strange that you should ask me. I've just begun to read. I'm getting myself educated on AI at a very, very primary level. My understanding is very, very limited. I think I think the challenge is really that AI would pose to us, apart from anything else, and something that would concern me, and something that I would be, I hope to educate myself more on, is the kind of ethical challenges that AI would place. And I think if one had to try and create an ethical ground of engagement with machines and intelligent machines, that for people like me will have to be an ethical ground and not a technical ground, because that's not our capacity at all. But I must say that I am unable to answer your question beyond that, because my reading into AI is very, very elementary. But if one were to look at from Gandhi's perspective, or even perspective of somebody like Tagore, would be that what is our self-volition vis-a-vis the machine? Do we retain what levels of autonomy do we retain in our interaction with the machine? It's not about the machine taking over the human society. I don't think that's the fear. The fear is that does the machine become the measure of human worth? And that's really the question that Gandhi is asking. That's the kind of question that a lot of ethical philosophers would ask, which is to say, do machines become the measure of human worth? And if the machines become measure of human worth, and which is really what the 20th century showed us, that the way we value human beings, value human societies, the way we place human societies in relationship to each other gets externalized. It's the attributes lie outside of the human being. And that's something that would begin to bother ethical philosophers. And that's Gandhi's unease with a civilization which measures human capacity as an external capacity. It's something that lies outside of human being. Somebody has sent me saying, I don't see a distinction. I don't know how Gandhi and science are linked. I wasn't trying to link Gandhi and science at all. If I were linking that, I would have, there was a point at which I thought that I would speak on the idea of the experiment what Gandhi thinks of the experiment, because he calls his autobiography My Experiments with Truth. But I thought that that was something that would not be something would interest or something that, you know, you do it all the time, and you didn't necessarily want somebody to come and say, there is another way of looking at the idea of the experiment and this is what happens. But yes, I mean, I do think that Gandhi had a fundamental thought on the idea of the experiment itself, and how does one arrive at truth? That's one. And how does one experiment with truth? Let's not forget that Gandhi's experiment or the autobiography is called Experimenting with Truth. How does one experiment with truth is really the thing which you know should appeal to the community of scientists and those who work even otherwise who work on questions of ethics and virtue also.
Thank you very much. I'm very thankful to you for this thought-provoking lecture, and it was absolutely wonderful. Again, thank you very much on behalf of the Fellowship and Associateship of the Indian Academy of Sciences. We hope to be able to continue to interact with you in the future, and we wish that, you know, after the coronavirus relents, we will have an opportunity to hear you in person. Professor Suhrud, thank you very much. We look forward to a written version of your lecture, because we are bringing out a compendium of all of these lectures. We will look forward to it. Thank you very much.